Andre. Welcome back. Ladies and gentlemen, our first performer was named the best stand-up comic of the year on the American Comedy Awards. We're pleased to have him back on the Sunday Comics. Would you please welcome with us, Mr. Dennis Wolfberg. Thank you. Please be seated. Please, please be seated. Thank you. Thank you. How are you doing? Nice to see you. Yes, these are my eyes. I hope they don't frighten you. I should be able to make a fortune in selling coffee, ladies and gentlemen, but thank you. Thank you very much. It is really a pleasure to be back in Los Angeles, my hometown now, and one of the great cities in these United States. It really is. And a city whose greatest feature, I believe, is that if somewhere in the city you are stopped, a red light, someone somehow will try to sell you fruit. Okay. And what a great feature that is, because I think we all recognize the connection between waiting for light and coming down with scurvy, ladies and gentlemen, but only here will somebody try to sell you citric acid. My old hometown is New York. I assume we have other New Yorkers, and a great city, but if you are stopped at a red light in New York, nobody will sell you fruit. They might spit on your windshield and then demand a quarter for this, but they will not sell you fruit. My New York friends will verify that, in fact, however, if you are waiting to get into the Lincoln Tunnel in New York City, the street vendors will sell you cutlery. And what a terrific feature this is, because many times I have found myself, when stuck in tunnel traffic, saying, if only I had service for six, let it know that I would be able to breathe these fumes in with far greater palatability. The New York street vendors are an incredible breed. With the warm weather, they are on force. They are not necessarily the most scrupulous human beings. 2 weeks ago, I was back in New York doing a show. There was a vendor outside of Bloomingdale's selling original Picassos. He had one for $29.90. And he said it was the only one Picasso did on black velvet, which is the one of dogs playing poker. I don't know if you're familiar, as only Picasso could capture in the velvet metier. New York is my old hometown. It is a city where I maintain an apartment and a car, insanely enough. Well, 2 weeks ago, while back visiting my town, I had a minor automotive mishap. While driving down Lexington Avenue, the light turned yellow. And for New Yorkers, this is an unmistakable signal to speed up, ladies and gentlemen, because after yellow, you cannot go. So the light turns yellow, I accelerate and zoomed through my space. Now, had the car in front of me done the same thing, the way God meant for drivers to do it, yellow, perhaps we would have not met under such abrupt circumstances. Interestingly enough, this was not my first yellow light accident. I had a more serious encounter several years back when, while driving down 2nd Avenue on that occasion, the light turned yellow. I accelerated, but on this occasion, the light turned red far more rapidly than I had anticipated, yes. Because when you see a yellow light, you generally predict how much time it will be and how much turf you can traverse in the interim. But it was red, and I jammed on my brakes, and I ended up stopped in the middle of the intersection, which, for many, many years of living in New York, I knew was not the place to be, ladies and gentlemen. And New Yorkers, God bless them, are so renowned for their patience. I was touched by how many suggestions came hurling my way. Corrective hand gestures and everything as to how to extricate myself from this automotive dilemma. I mean, I wanted to drive forward, but already a group of eager pedestrians had begun crossing the transversal, bless their ambulatory little hearts, by the way. So left with no option, I put my car in reverse, I backed up, and I waited. And when the light turned green, I put my foot down, having forgotten one minor detail, ladies and gentlemen. this predicament. So you could imagine the shock on my face, not to mention the shock on the face of the guy behind me, as we suddenly became one. The man behind me, a New York taxi cab driver. Yes, yes, one of the lowest forms of humanity, ladies and gentlemen. A man who had not only a truculent attitude, but a name that had 9 consecutive consonants. I tried to break the tension with some humor. I said, "You speak English." You people are laughing, and you don't even live in New York, but this man apparently had his sense of humor surgically removed when he passed through immigration. And thus began an interchange that would have done the House of Commons proud. He loved the first salvo when he called me not so much a person as an orifice, ladies and gentlemen. And considering he did not have great command of the language, I was impressed with his knowledge of anatomical parts, particularly one where the sun don't shine. I responded by suggesting that he had been born without the benefit of wedlock. He responded by suggesting that I was a practitioner of incest. I responded by suggesting that he was the offspring of a female canine, to which he then suggested that I do something to myself that, were I to have obliged, might have resulted in my becoming pregnant, ladies and gentlemen. He must have thought me hermaphroditic, not to mention double-jointed, and in fact I said, if I could do that,